When I received the notice that I had neglected and abused my children, I was devastated.
I was angry, pissed off.
It's scary.
Denial. Not me. No way.
But most of all, I was worried about my daughter.
I already knew that I had a problem, but facing that problem was really scary. They mentioned that they already had somebody set up to adopt all six of my kids. And then having to go to court, having all those emotions and the fear was horrible.
All rise, 3rd District Juvenile Court is now in session.
Your Honor, as you can see from the court report, my client's been doing everything.
I'm a parental defense attorney, so my role is to make sure the parents' constitutional rights are protected. Out of court, my job is to give them the best advice possible. Something in court I never got used to was when the judge would say, your parental rights are terminated. That's something I never wanted to happen to my clients.
Judge, we have reached a stipulation. I've spoken. My job is to take the facts that the Division of Child and Family Services has brought to us. They've identified some problems and concerns, things that are unsafe and unhealthy. I put that into a petition, bring it to the court, and the court decides what they're going to do for the family from there.
I agree with the stipulation.
I'm a GAL. I represent abused, neglected, and dependent children in juvenile court. I've always had a passion for issues involving children.
Thanks for coming, TJ. I know this is a really nervous
The role that I have in the courtroom is to ensure that I lead the proceedings, to direct people when to speak, and also serve as a sort of referee in the courtroom. I choose to work in the juvenile court because I like to help people make changes in their lives, to make their lives better, to make families stronger.
My role is to help families navigate the system. No one has set out to be a bad parent. We don't work with bad parents.
My first hearing that I went to, it was very overwhelming. I was very scared. I didn't feel like I was seen as a person or as a mom who lost her kids. I was seen as a drug addict.
Parents have the misconception that I'm there to make their situation worse. This isn't a criminal court and it's not about punishment. What it's about is identifying what factors in your life have gone out of control and what we can do to do a service plan or to assist you to find some treatment that you're not otherwise able to get.
It's not an us versus them type of thing. The idea is to build a support network around the family, around the children, around the parents.
It's about the children and coming up with a way that the children will be safe.
The person that had the most effect on me was the guardian ad litem, and I thought she was pure evil from day one. The longer I stayed sober, the more I could realize that this group of people around me was actually here to help. She's somebody that I really admire now.
It's important to have children in the courtroom to help give us feedback on what their needs are, because it's important for a child to feel included in their own case. We are really about protecting the family unit.
They want you to get better for your children because your children deserve to have you.
We're building a safe home for the children to return to.
My attorney would do whatever it took to make me feel comfortable and to help me towards getting reunification and my kids back.
And we can help you build it, but we've got to make sure that we have those bricks.
And what I had to do was provide the action steps to get there.
Now those bricks are taking care of everything that DCFS is having you take care of.
Yeah, we go to jail court every week.
Is it's bringing the proof back to court. Maybe you can bring a letter from your work supervisor that says you're doing great at work, or maybe you've been promoted. Those types of letters are like gold. They can help us show, here's the house, here's the bricks that we're building up, and look how safe this house is. Look how ready it is for my children to come home.
The road toward building that safe home environment often begins with a shelter hearing, where the court considers temporarily removing your child from your home.
At that shelter hearing, DCFS has the burden of showing, number one, that the removal was appropriate. And if they want to keep the children out of the house longer, then they have to show why. But that's not the day we're going to make the big fight, if there is going to be one.
At the shelter hearing, your child may be placed with the Division of Child and Family Services, who would then place the child with a relative, friend, or foster care family. Or your child may be allowed to remain in your home, so long as you obey specific court orders.
At the end of the shelter hearing, I will set a pretrial hearing as required by statute. I will also offer the parents a chance to attend mediation.
I'm a huge fan of mediation. I think it's very effective. It gives the parents an opportunity to explain where they're coming from.
After mediation, the court proceeds to the pre-trial hearing, where the parties will tell the judge about any changes they have agreed to make to the petition. You will then have a chance to either admit or deny each paragraph of the petition. Parents also have a third option, known as the 34E plea. If you enter a 34E plea, the juvenile court, and only the juvenile court, will assume that the paragraph is true. And it can keep that in mind as it makes future decisions involving your case.
The 34E plea is neither an admission nor a denial. This is a really useful plea for parents who especially have criminal issues pending in another court because it allows their juvenile court matter to move forward without making admissions that might hurt them in the other court.
If you deny the petition, the court will set the matter for trial. If you admit the petition, you give up your right to a trial and to an appeal.
At the trial, the burden of proof is on the state to prove by clear and convincing evidence that the allegations that they put into the petition are true.
We can fight over which facts are true and which facts aren't. We'll have a chance to bring our own witnesses and cross-examine the state's witnesses, and it's their burden.
After admission to the petition or conclusion of the trial, if the court finds the petition to be all or partially true, you'll proceed to a disposition hearing. At this hearing, the court will set a goal for the court's involvement with the family. Successful reunification depends on how well parents adhere to the Child and Family Service Plan.
It's not just created by the court or the judge. It's not just created by the division. It is created by the team.
So we're saying to the judge, if we do these things, when you're done with them, it should be a safe situation.
So you've had 20, 25 years to develop a substance abuse problem or to live with your mental health problem, and you have to fix that in 12 months. It's asking a lot. I think the ballpark you want to make sure you're playing in from day one is, I've got 12 months, and I'm not even guaranteed that 12 months. If I mess around in the first 3 months, they could close my case.
After we've been reviewing the case for a period of time and we've been checking on the parents' progress, there does come a point where the statutes require us to have what's called a permanency hearing. And at the permanency hearing, the court has to decide if the parents are in substantial compliance with the Child and Family Plan and if reunification is likely.
The cases that I have seen that have been the most successful are cases where parents have engaged in the services.
Surrender to the process because the process works.
Follow the steps and within the timelines that they're given.
Those cases that have succeeded have been the ones where they have jumped in and where they've kept the children's needs in the forefront.
Just don't expect instant gratification.
As soon as the judge put down the gavel and given me the custody back of the kids, the whole courtroom stood up and gave me a standing ovation.
I was ecstatic. I was super excited. I was proud of myself when I regained custody back for all my hard work and knowing that my life was going to be different from there on out.
I had climbed that insurmountable mountain. It was the best day of my life.
When you go to the first hearing, it's not the last hearing. It's not over. It's only just the beginning. Get through that day and move on to the next day and just make progress.
The fight is worth it. Anybody can do it. It's totally possible. Thank you.